All right, there you go. We're recording. So Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you that that our nation is recovering. Thank you for businesses being able to open again. Thank you, Lord, for lives being saved. And of course, Lord, we continue to be with those who have lost loved ones through the pandemic. I mean, this is really the first day of being fully open again since the initial shutdown. And so we're grateful for that, Lord. We're grateful that we are here together with each other. And Father, we pray your protection over us. We pray that you would hide us from the enemy, that you would cover us, that you would keep us healthy and strong. Lord, be with those that can't be here tonight but would like to. And whatever they're doing, Father, just bless them. And bless our time together, that we would glorify you and that we would learn whatever it is that you have to teach us tonight. We give thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So most of you you're probably aware at some level of some of the stuff that's been going on. I mean, it has been a challenging few weeks in Good Samaritan Ministries. We've lost some very key people. I was the director that I started the work in Pendleton, and the woman that took over for me was Dee Dee Jones. Dee Dee has been the director for, I think, 14 years now. I was director for 13 years, and so she's one more year than me at this point. And she's also the satellite director for Haiti. And over the last couple of years, her son, who was 36, began showing signs of ALS. Took quite a while to diagnose him. And this last year, he just degenerated very quick. And Ryan passed away this week. It was, Ryan was an amazing young man. He had been very addicted, both drug and alcohol. And he went to our drug and alcohol treatment center in the West Bank. Wow. So can you imagine going through drug and alcohol treatment in an Arab treatment center where you have to rely on the little bit of English that a few of the other people there know? Majid knows English very well, who is our director in Palestine of the treatment center. But Ryan went through treatment in Israel, and he came back, and then he went back again. But he spent a lot of time working with our director of what we call Rose of Jerusalem. And it was a facility or a program where Yassin Hamdan worked with disabled children and had an incredible ministry there for a lot of years. And then Yassin's health got so bad that he had to close the Rose of Jerusalem. But now his daughter has opened up a daycare center. So we still have very significant work in the West Bank. But Ryan, he slowly deteriorated until he could no longer talk. He was totally in bed in a wheelchair, and he had a computer that he could run with his eyes. And that was the last thing that went with him. And Betty would call him, and he would write on the computer, and Dee Dee would read to Betty what Ryan was saying. And the last that Betty called, he had lots of questions about heaven. And he was very happy with all of Betty's answers for him. And he was ready to go. Dee Dee texted me and said that she was on her knees asking the Lord out loud to take him home. And she said he died instantly.
Did she ask the Lord that in his presence.
Yes, she was kneeling by Ryan's bed and asking the Lord to take him home, and he died instantly. And she said, and then her husband and her, Tony and her, washed his body with lavender and frankincense. But, tough story.
I just lost my best friend.
Did you?
She's in heaven.
Mm-hmm. And how did she, what did she
die? She was 77, and she had heart disease, and her heart failed, and her liver failed, and then she went downhill fast, and then her organs started shutting down. And then I'm thankful for the time I had with her. Anyway, I don't mean to get off on.
No, it's significant. It's because, we've been ensuring the news that she has terminal cancer and that it is stage 4. And she said it was the best day of her life when she learned her diagnosis. She gets to go home, and Betty says, you have seen nothing yet. She says, when I pass, I'm going to be an intercessor in heaven for you. And she says, you will see things that you've never seen before. And she's still leading the men's group right now. She is noticeably weaker. She just did a pastor's conference, which was an all-day ordeal. The last 2 hours, she was like, but she's living until she dies, She has chosen not to go through any really intensive treatment. She is taking a mild chemo that just keeps the fluid off of her lung, because the cancer is in her female organs and has metastasized to her lungs. And she says she's in no pain at this point. So that is a blessing. And I told her when we first found out, I said, well, Betty, I'm going to pray that you don't have to go through a lot of pain. She goes, well, if I do it. I said, Betty, stop it. I said, you have enough pain. You don't need any more. Betty has truly paid the price for this ministry. So we continue to keep Betty in our prayers. And Betty has been showing us how to live all these years. She's going to show us how to die. Gracefully. She has no fear. Zero. And so then we had Alec Malama, who has been the director, the national director of our work in Zambia since 1994, passed away from COVID. And he was in the hospital. And Claudia, who is online here, is our satellite director for Zambia, and she was texting him the day that he died or the day before. Bobby, would you like to share about Alec?
You're muted.
He didn't tell many people. He was taking calls and things, but not sharing that he was in the hospital. And I texted him, and he, why haven't I heard from you about this and that and the other that we're discussing? And he said, well, I'm in the hospital. And so I started texting him every day to just keep tabs on how he was doing. And he told me that he had slept well the night before and would be going home soon. And the next day, I believe, he died. He did go home.
Yeah, I've thought of that, Claudia, a few times, that it was, he prophetically said he was going home.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. But he did not have any extenuating conditions. Is that how you say it? Any conditions. He was a healthy man. But in Zambia, they don't have vaccines. And if they do have them, people are very fearful of taking them. And so it was a hard thing for him to grapple with. And so he never did have a vaccine. I'm not even sure by that time that they were available to all, because ones that had been sent into the country were out of date. And some of the ones from China, I'm not sure exactly where they originated from. So anyway, it's a huge loss. I'm very sad.
Yeah. You've had a relationship with Ali for
many. He was my brother.
Yes. I met Alec in 1994 when we had the first international conference here, and we brought all of our national directors from around the world to the United States for the first time together. And we've only had two of those conferences. We had one in 1994 and then 2002, and we were supposed to have one in 2020, and all of that was canceled due to COVID. But Alec has been one of our key leaders, an incredibly anointed, gifted teacher, preacher, counselor. You can't help but love the man when you've been around him for a while.
Great sense of humor. He was so funny.
Very talented.
A lot.
Too. Yeah. And then ironically, or by God's design, the mystery is, then later that week, we lost Mary White, who is the founder of the Zambia satellite. And she too died of COVID. But she had been in and out of the hospital. In fact, Claudia, you might.
She had started off with a sore throat, went to urgent care. They told her she was just coming down with a cold. They didn't do a test or anything. She went back a couple times, and by that time it had developed more. I think she was in the hospital about 6 days. She was alone. Nobody could come in to visit. It was difficult for her to, she couldn't communicate on the phone, and so her family members couldn't talk to her, and texting upset her. So it was a difficult end for her. This has been a tough week, and then my puppy died. So I am really sad.
And Claudia was not only connected with Mary through the Zambia satellite, but Mary has been there for Bible studies with her family, right, in the Vancouver area. And so this has been a rough week on Claudia.
Yeah, not one of the better ones.
Yeah. So let's just pray right now for all concerned in this situation. Father, you know, and I just remind myself that for you, gathering the saints home to your home is a great blessing, and it is a great honor for the saints that arrive at your door. That for them, it is the day of rest and the day of restitution and being set free from this earthly bondage. So, Lord, we rejoice with Alec and with Mary that they are together. And Lord, I just need to believe that Claudia's puppy's with them. And the fat poppy's rejoicing with Alec and Mary too, waiting for Claudia's day. But Father, you know how our hearts hurt here on earth. And so we just lift up the family of Alec and Mary, all of their friends, neighbors, acquaintances, people who are affected by their absence here. And Lord, all of the details that need to be taken care of after the death of somebody can be very complicated. And Lord, we pray for Alec's family and just the resolution of all the details in Zambia. And our plans, Lord, to have a celebration of life, to celebrate these two people who poured their lives out for your kingdom. Lord, let us honor and bless them in every way. And we'll give you thanks. Amen. Amen. So that's, you know, that's the major news that we had going on here. And it's been pretty shocking for us to have all of this in a week. But God knows, and we are in his hands. And we do look forward to what is it, God, that you're doing? There's a reason for all of this.
I am needing to stop trying to figure out.
Yeah.
Because it's just messing me up, man.
Uh-huh.
It changes like, seems like momentarily.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Cindy?
Cindy?
Oh. I actually was going to ask, Hannah's about to speak. I was going to ask if Hannah would speak up because they're having a tremendous time there and I wanted her to share. I only know parts of it, but I think it'd be great for us to be in prayer together for them as well.
Good. Hannah, what would you like to share?
Yeah, first of all, I thank God for this time and for this class. We also lost one of our board members, was called John Kajabwango, who also died of COVID. And right now we are in the second wave of COVID and there are many deaths. We are in a lockdown of 42 days. The schools are closed, the churches are closed. It's kind of traumatizing. It's so hard. People are really dying. And like we are overwhelmed. There are many questions from children. Why are we not going to school? We are in fear. They have anxiety. They have everything. We are praying. We are counseling. We are doing all we, whatever God has entrusted us with, trying to help them, but we are also kind of overwhelmed. It's kind of hard and tough. So I'm asking if you could also pray for us. Like it's not only Uganda, but it's Africa, most of the African countries, and there are no vaccines. Some vaccines are not genuine, some are fake, like, you know, it's really, really, really hard, but we know God is with us. And yeah, we're looking up to him because he said we should not be anxious for anything. But as human beings, you know, sometimes you fall back and say, Lord, this is what is happening. And yeah, so I'm asking if you could also pray for us. And yeah, we know through it all, God is going to help us go through it. Yes. And what happened, I also suddenly did not start feeling well last night. My chest has been hurting last week, but all of a sudden last night I wasn't breathing well. But I'm glad by faith I woke up. I'm up to be in class because even I failed to sleep. Literally, I did not sleep tonight. Now it's 4:00, 4:25. But yeah, so pray for us, because we know there is power in prayer, and we know there is when we agree in prayer, God, yeah, God answers prayers. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Thank you, Hannah, for sharing.
Love you.
Love you too.
Sabrina, could you lead us in prayer for Hannah, for Uganda, for all of Africa? You need to unmute.
I just wanted to say today I was wearing this dress that Hannah gave me when she was here. And it's comforting to me. Whenever I don't feel too good, I put it on. And it just so happens to be tonight that we're in class. And it reminds me, Lord, thank you. You are the comforter. Yeah. And we need you tonight. We need you all the time. Thank you for this beautiful gift of fellowship, speaking spirit to spirit together tonight with the Holy Spirit, Lord. We pray, Father, that you comfort those in desperate need of comforting all over Africa, all over Uganda, those hurting children, the scared children, where they don't know what's happening. Any bit of security and stability, Father, give them your peace and your stability.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, that even in these moments tonight, as we fellowship together, you're here with us, guiding us. Lord, we pray especially over Hannah's body right now, Lord. You deliver her from anxiety and worry and pain and suffering. Thank you, Father, that you're in her and you're in all of us, Lord. Give the leaders wisdom of these African countries during this terrible time of pandemic. Lord, bring your peace about the countries and not unrest. Creative solutions for the practical daily suffering. We ask you for miracle healings. And that your love covers all the multitudes in their hurting and pain. Thank you, Lord, for the shared suffering that you showed us, and that we can share in suffering and carry each other's burdens and lift them to you.
Yes.
Thank you, my precious sister. Mm-hmm. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Mama, for sharing. So, moving on from that somber moment, I'd like to just spend a little bit of time with each of you introducing yourselves and maybe sharing where you're at in the counselor training program.
Could you unmute yourself? You're real soft.
Well, I can't unmute me, but I can move my speaker. We have this challenge that we can only have one computer unmuted.
Okay, so can you hear me now? Is that better?
But now you're muted.
Okay, yeah. She says
yes. Okay. Okay, here we go. So I think as we introduce here in the room, I'd like to have you come trade places with me so that they can see you up close on the computer. Okay, so we'll have one of our graduates come up. Rich, you want to come introduce yourself first?
I will. I am. Look over here.
You can do that.
Hi, guys. Hey, I'm actually in the room. I'm not in the Zoom. So, but if you don't know me already or don't forgot who I am, I'm Rich. Last name's Mann, Rich Mann. And I did last year counseling level 1 and counseling level 2. And turn in all my stuff, so be envious of me. So I don't have to worry about that, all those paperwork things. Got done. Now I'm ready to do the stuff that I really care about, which is the counseling part. And so tell you a little bit about myself. My background is I was a middle school teacher 31 years in St. Kaiser Schools. And I taught science and coached football and wrestling most of that time. And also married 35 years, got 2 kids or adults that live in Hillsboro, which is where I live. And I moved, we moved because grandkids came up. So my wife didn't want to have to drive the highway all the time. So glad we moved before all the prices jumped super skyrockety. And I'm just going to be doing this all summer. So, and I teach DBT on Thursdays at 10 o'clock in the morning. And after I'm done with this, I'll be doing it at 6 at night as well. Nice seeing you. Hope all's doing well.
Okay. All right. Thanks, Rich. Colleen, you want to go next? I'm going to go ahead and have everybody in this room share, and then we'll go to those of you online.
Okay, my turn to look. Can you see me?
Yeah.
Okay.
You're real.
It's funny. There are 1, 2, 3, 4 people in the room, but I'm not looking at them. I'm looking at them on the screen. So anyway, I just took counselor training 1. I, unlike Rich, have not turned in all the paperwork. Papers and me don't get along very well. I have a pretty bad vision problem. And with pink papers and things that are written down, you have to look at them. And my eyes don't like that. And other things don't like that too. So, but anyway, I'm still, you know, trying to do that as much as I can. And I'm not sure if this part, this practicum in the summer is going to involve paperwork, but I guess I'm going to find out. I live in nearby here, and single, never married, never kids, never any of that stuff. When I was 26, I had a really, I almost died. Apparently I should have died, but literally not should have because I didn't. So my life since then has been trying to regain things. Like I relearned how to walk and how to talk, and I still can't do things. Like I can't see very well, and I can't remember very well, and I can't think very well, and all that. But I looked at it, I can smile. So that's helpful. I don't know what else. I guess that's a
question. What is your name?
Oh, I'm sorry. Just for here, I'll just mentally telepathy that. It's Colleen. My name is Colleen. Okay. Thank you.
And Colleen, you didn't say that what happened, it was a traumatic brain injury.
Oh, right. So I was in a sailboat race and had a traumatic brain injury. I was hit on the head, knocked me out of course. I almost died. And Yeah.
And here you are.
You're a miracle.
Yeah, a living miracle.
Well, I'm living, and there was a miracle. I don't feel like I'm a miracle, but yeah, okay. So I'm glad to be, now I'm glad to be still fighting this fight, but I haven't been glad a lot of the time. It's been rough going.
Yep.
But, you know, at least for right now, it's okay. Yeah. All right, so I'll see you later on these Thursday nights.
We're glad you're here.
Yes.
Thank you. Very glad. Nikki, you want to go?
I was going to go with Dr. Walker, but I decided better not.
Yeah.
Better safe than sorry.
Yeah. No
falling.
It's easier on us too if you take the walker and don't hurt yourself.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Vicki. And I went through, I'm on my third, I kind of went through three, but it got confused with COVID and stuff like that. Two and three happened about two times. And so, I am looking to do the trying to get in to sit in on some counseling and doing some intake and other things that I need to do.
You're beginning to intern.
Oh, okay. That's
there
how
you
say it. I am intern. And I've always wanted to counsel for years and years, and I love this timing that God has, because I love the fact that God is the counselor and I'm not, and mm-hmm. just the team that's together is just so awesome to me, and I write what God teaches me, and so as I wrote each paper, God gave me a person to show that paper to. And so it was like, wow, they got to go, whoa, okay, I understand now. And I get to, on the 14th, I get to do four of my papers and get some feedback from some people on it. And so I'm really excited about that. And because I want to put the books together of what God has taught me, so I can be able to share that with others.
Thank you, Vicki.
Me?
You. I think you're the only one left.
I'm the only one in the class. In the room.
In the room.
I'm not in the room yet. Hi, I'm Carol. My last name is Cleworth. I just graduated from level one. Yay! I'm so excited. And I'm looking forward to level two and level three. And always wanted to be a counselor. I have had quite a bit of counseling myself over the years and just always wanted to be one. Never finished school, but this is the best school out of all the schools. So it's good I waited. I am single and I don't have kids. And I'm just looking forward to the future in counseling. Thank you.
Okay, so let's go to those of you online. How about you, Susanna? Who would you like to share?
I'm Susanna Maria. It's my last name. A lot of people will say, what's your name? What's your first name? I'll say Susanna. No, and what's your last name? And I'll say Maria. Your last name, Maria. Anyway, I am in the training too. Technically, I did that, but I haven't turned in all my paperwork, but I'm hoping to have that done before the next one starts. I believe that's what you said, right? We have to have it done by August? Is that right?
Yeah, classes start again in September.
Oh.
August.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, I should have it done by then. Right now, I live in Vancouver, Washington. I just moved. I sold my condo and I moved into an apartment complex. And God has treated me really well in the place that I'm living. And as far as counselor training is concerned, well, I'm not sure why I'm taking it, actually, other than two couple things God has asked me to. And I've learned a lot for myself, but it's kind of overwhelming, actually, because I feel like, well, I think I have so much changing to do, and it feels overwhelming. So that's where I'm at right now.
Okay. Thank you, Susanna. Okay, and Claudia, what would you like to share?
I'm a retired primary teacher. I taught kindergarten and first grade for many, many, many years. And then my body said, it's time to quit. So now I'm involved in Good Samaritan Ministries. Betty gave me the assignment to be on the Zambia satellite, and I'm now leading it along with another person, and it is a joy to know those people. They're very dear. They're my family in Africa. It is, I have resisted going through counselor training. I have resisted it. And yet I've never been at peace about stopping. So I did stop for a while on the training. I got through level one, and then about halfway through last year, I really felt impelled from, you know, and pushed by the Lord to continue. So I'm sort of like more than halfway through level two, but it's like I finished the end of it. I have to go back and do the beginning of it. Not sure how that's all going to work, Cindy, but you'll help me figure it out.
Yeah.
The learning part is fabulous. And I am learning a lot. I'm thankful for the camaraderie and the spiritual connection of people at GSM. They are almost more important to me. They're like my church, my spiritual home. So there's a deep connection. And I'm not just sure what's going to happen when I finish level two. I'm really not, but that's okay. I don't need to know right now. I'm just carrying on with the tasks. I'm really good at task completion. So we'll see what happens after I've done all the busyness and I have to face talking to people. Ooh. Intimidating. That's about it.
Yeah. I love it, Claudia. I mean, I think that's a great example is you just do what is in front of you today. And when the Lord wants to move you to the next place, you'll be there, you know?
just a day at a time, a step at a time. And when the Lord says the next thing, you won't be shocked and you'll be ready for it. That doesn't mean you won't be scared.
That's right. Fear, I've had to kind of bypass the fear, step around it, and just focus on the Holy Spirit in me and what he is saying to me, and not let the enemy come in and play around with my brain and my emotions. So, but I do want to say also to Hannah that I have such a heart for Uganda, and I will be in prayer, as I know the children are suffering and it's a very hard thing. So.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And Hannah, would you like to go ahead and share next?
Yeah, I'm called Hannah Sally Nyakaisiki. I'm here in Uganda, and I am so grateful to the Lord for this class. And I was looking forward to, to train, counseling training. Like, I thank God who really made it for us, as these Zoom classes. When I was there in 2019, I interacted with Mama Cindy, told her how really, really deeply I wanted to train, and because the way of how we do things here was different, and how we're training, we are more of a pastoral counseling kind of, but we are training counselors in a different way. So when this class came up, I was so happy. It was like God had answered my prayers, because we interact with so many people with so many things going on. We have children, like in Masaka, we have like 400 children. We have teachers and people in the community, also centers here. So things have been happening, but having this training has not helped me to acquire the skills, but also inner healing, because many things have been going on in my life and around me. So having this class was really, really an answered prayer, and I really look forward to what the Lord is going to do in us. So I'm calling also some people to join class level one, for them to help us with the training and also counseling. So it is really, really, knowledge is power. So I'm so grateful. And I really love my class. I love everyone. And above all, when we are going to start this class, Mama Cindy had talked about a partner or someone, you know, you can interact with concerning class stuff. And God laid it on my heart to tell Sabrina, to tell her that, you know what, can you please attend the class? And really, I'm so grateful she accepted to join class, and we have done the class together. She helped me with getting the, what's so amazing about Grace, we did the work together. So I'm glad we walked the journey together, and also every class member, I'm so grateful for you being there, sharing your experiences, and indeed, God has done as well. So we're looking forward to what God is entrusting us with. So we are using it one day at a time. We did know that at such a time as this, we will really need to be equipped, because I don't know what we would have done without being trained, entrusted with this knowledge. God does things in his way, and he knows why he do them. So we're really, really, really blessed. So thank you so much. Mm-hmm. God bless. Yes.
You know, Hannah, God sees you. I want to share an incredible story about, to God's glory. It is so amazing. I didn't meet Hannah until 2017, when we went over there to do a director's conference in Uganda. And that was the first that I got to meet Hannah. And we were there for several days. And I asked somebody, I guess it was Patty Pullen, said something to me about Hannah's brother. And I said, what? And I asked his name again. And she says, well, it's Stephen. And I can't pronounce your last name, Hannah. And I went, oh my gosh. Hannah, what year was it that your mother passed away?
Passed away in 1994, September 29th.
Okay, so that year, Hannah's mother was a very significant person in the founding of the ministry in Uganda. She was a key leader. She had gone to Kenya for training, and at that time we were sending people to Kenya for 3 months at a time. So her mother had gone to Kenya, her mother passed away. And Hannah, I don't remember whether she was in Kenya or whether she had come back from Kenya, but
She had come back, and that is the very year she went for the training. Because she was there in 1994, around starting in June. But when he came back, she really fell sick, and she died in September.
And so Hannah and her siblings did not know that their mother had HIV, and she passed away. So it was a great tragedy to all of them. But her brother was touring the United States with the African Children's Choir as one of their leaders. And I lived in this little Pendleton, Oregon, and the African Children's Choir was supposed to tour the East Coast, this specific group was, and they switched their tour to the West Coast, and they came to Pendleton. And they came to the church that I was in. It was a four square church. And my husband and I always housed people when they came. And so we offered to house several of the children. And I'm standing in the lobby and I'm hearing this young man telling somebody the story that his mother had just died and that he was very grieved. And it's like, I got chills and I went, oh my gosh. And because I knew they were from Uganda, and I just thought, what are the odds? And I went up to him and I asked him, I said, is your mother Flora Mutaka? And he about fell on the floor. It was like, how would you know that? And I said, I am with Good Samaritan Ministries. And I said, we have been grieving your mother. And Stephen was just, he had not been able to, you know, he couldn't go home. He couldn't be with his family. He couldn't really actively grieve because he had no connections. And so we went to the director and said, we want Stephen at our house. And they kind of argued with us. And I said, no, there's no argument. Stephen is staying at our house. And he did. And the next place that this group went was Beaverton. And I got hold of Betty, I got hold of Betty when he was at our house, and I said, Betty, you will never believe who's standing in our living room. I said, it's Flora Mataka's son. And so they went to Beaverton, and Betty did basically the same thing. She went to the director, and she says, Stephen will stay with me. And Betty had a video of Flora singing and teaching in Yoranga. And Stephen got to see his mother and to grieve with the ministry over his mother's death. And then when we went to Uganda, I did not know that Hannah was Stephen's sister. And so when I overheard that, and then of course, when Hannah and I looked at each other and it's like, oh my gosh, and we both start bawling and grab each other and hug. And but this is God. How is that possible? That this young man shows up at our where we house him, and then the next place is at Betty's. I think maybe God had a hand in that. What do you think?
Yeah.
Isn't that amazing? And then the profound connection that we have ongoing with Hannah now. And she is an amazing leader, amazing teacher, mother, wife, leader, all of those things. And she gets up at 4 o'clock in the morning to come to these classes. Wow. Actually, you probably get up more like 3:30 so that you can be ready for class. But we're so glad that you're with us, Hannah, and we hold you deeply and profoundly in prayer at all times. Love you much.
So much. Love you too. Thank you.
Okay. Marion, would you like to share next?
Hi, everybody. I'm... That was very touching, Cindy. I got choked up. So I'm part of the Caldwell GSM group. There are three of us. Director is Angie Nichols, and then Ruth Ann, and then myself. I'm Marion Heim. I was Marion Goheen until... till 3 years ago when I got remarried. My first husband died in December of 2013. He'd been a pilot with Mission Aviation Fellowship, and we had served overseas in Bukavu, Zaire, East DRC now, and then 6.5 years in Mali, West Africa, and then... the last 8 years that my husband was living, we served in Afghanistan under our humanitarian branch. And after he passed away, I worked with Mission Aviation Fellowship's member care department. And when I first started there, I didn't really know what member care was. And member care has a lot of overlap with counseling, but I'd never really been drawn to counseling. I had been exposed to peer crisis debriefing when we were in Afghanistan, and I was very drawn to that. And as I learned more about member care, I found my heart echoing that passage from Isaiah a couple of passages, one about rebuilding the broken ruins, and another one about binding up the wounds of the brokenhearted. And but looking back over all the years of ministry, I so wish that I'd had the training that Good Samaritan has offered. It's been a real blessing, and it's also been very humbling as I've seen growth that I wish could have happened years ago, and didn't have the training or the tools or the knowledge. But we learn from the past. Nothing is lost, and God uses the mistakes, and He uses the experiences we have to form Christ in us, and then to work through us and touch other people's and help people and help them with healing. I've completed 3 years in training with GSM, and am trying to finish up the requirements for the level 3, and went through the level 2 class this last year by Zoom. And let's see. My family, in addition to my husband who passed away, I have 3 sons. The oldest just got accepted this early this summer with Mission Aviation Fellowship, or was commissioned with Mission Aviation Fellowship, and he's assigned to go back to Africa, to Niankundi and East DRC. But he's, for the present, he's got a year's assignment in the hangar at MAF headquarters in Nampa, Idaho. My middle son is getting married next week, and my youngest son is trying to work his way through college at Northwest Nazarene University and work part-time. And he's got a fiance as well, but they haven't set a date. So that's me.
Oh, wow. You have a wedding next week.
Yep.
Yeah. Wow. Well, thank you, Mary. We've been so blessed to have you with us. And you do bring a lot of rich experience and background with you that has been so valuable to all of us. Thank you. Alta, what would you like to share?
Hi, everyone. Good evening. In morning. You in Uganda, morning, right? Yeah. So good evening and good morning. Yeah. So I'm Alta. I'm from Mongolia. And was born in Mongolia, in capital city, Mongolia, Ulaanbaatar. And my background is a middle school teacher. I've been teaching at middle school in Ulaanbaatar like more than 20 years. And I was looking for a better life in coming to America and living now in Virginia with my husband. And I have two children, a son and a boy. My son lives back in Mongolia. He has his family, and I'm a grandmother of two granddaughters, twins, my son. And my daughter lives here. And I met with God back in Mongolia when I had a horrible time in my life. And I was trying to make my life and everything as much as better. That's why I moved here and living here and attending this Mongolian, Washington Mongolian Church. And as a member of the church, I am almost like more than 10 years, like in serving in this church. And last year, I started attending the GSM Bible class of Yanjima, and I learned a lot from Yanjima, and Yanjima is like a Mongolian director, right? She's a Mongolian director, and she asked me to attend this class, and during the last year, I've been attending level one, all the classes I have attended, but with the paperwork, I still a little not finished yet. So hoping to finish in August, by the August, before the second level, I'm planning to study in second level because I won't be, I had lots of trouble and lots of difficulties in my life. And I wish the other people also facing all these things, of course. So I wish help get more experience and knowledge and help the other people how to struggle, how to fight with this, and how to be stronger in life. So that's why I'm very much trying to attend and to finish this counselor class and to become a counselor. Yeah, maybe that's all. Thank you.
Alta, we are so blessed that you're with us. We thank you for your commitment, and you know, Alta's up late at night. She finishes about midnight when we finish class here. So we're just grateful that you're with us. And Sabrina is the same too. She's on the
in the morning.
Yeah.
And also I have a prayer request. Please also pray for my Mongolia also. Mongolia has also struggling in facing struggling with COVID.
Oh, it's
very, very horrible. Yeah. Every day almost two or three these pregnant people, ladies dying. And it's very hard time we're having. Same as the all over the world. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing, Alta. And yes, we will continue to keep Mongolia in prayer. Yanja Jutman is national director, and she also is living in right now. But we'll be returning to Mongolia. And she's an amazing, amazing woman, very highly educated. And in fact, she's going to be here next week. You will get to meet Yanjima.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Hey, Cindy, this is Deanna. Can I please interrupt?
Yeah, I was going to ask you to share next. So.
Good, because I'm running out of time. I'm probably going to have to get off the Zoom here pretty soon. So I'm glad it's being recorded, because I really don't want to miss everybody else. But I've been driving for 6 hours for my paying job, and so I pulled over at a rest stop, and I'll have to get off soon. But so I'm Deanna Wallace, and I live northwest of the Beaverton office by about an hour, 45 minutes, if I go over the speed limit. But I just finished level two. I'm very excited. Level one. I'm very excited to start level two. And we have started a center at our ranch. It's called New Days Hope. And so we have people who have experienced trauma come to work with the horses, or play in the woods, or do archery. We have a garden, so we like to give people vegetables. My husband and I have worked in with lots of foster children, and we adopted, so we ended up having 13 children. 26 grandkids, and at the end of this day, I will get to see my seventh great grandbaby for the first time. And so we're really blessed. Ministry wise, we just had our first camp at the ranch last week, which was really awesome. And our theme was trusting in the Lord. And so I believe that we were able to really encourage the children and the families that were there to trust in the Lord. We had some really great times. And then after that, I cut and raked and baled our hay field so that our horses will have food this winter. And the Lord helped me learn how to back up a trailer, which I've never been able to do in my life. And so on top of all his other blessings, he helped me learn how to do that amazing thing. But I am just so thankful to the Lord to be able to be involved with Good Samaritan Ministries. I've had lots and lots of training in my life, but nothing like this. And so I am thankful. I love it. And I'm so thankful for Cindy and Teresa and Betty and all the other people that I have am meeting through Good Samaritan Ministries.
Hey, thank you, Deanna. Where are you at right on the road?
I'm almost to Redmond.
Are you on your way or out?
I'm going to Redmond to work in our Redmond office for a couple of days.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Take care. Drive carefully.
Thank you. Bless you all. Hope next week, my prayer is that I, Lord willing, I will be in the Beaverton office for this class, I hope.
Well, we'll pray with you for that.
Thank you. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. I see that Joe is back with us again. Joe, would you like to share?
Yes. Good evening, everybody.
You're out of the car now.
Yeah, I was driving to Newburgh and up in the hills and getting lost in the signals. And so I've just said, I'll just wait and come home. So I'm right home, back home now. I was going to, my in-laws have a lavender farm and they have the Oregon Lavender Growers Festival coming up beginning tomorrow. So I had to go to Newburgh to pick up some lavender lemonade that is made there. So that's what the trip was for. So I'm happy to be back. And I'm sorry that I missed some people who spoke already, but God, it's nice that it's being taped and we'll be able to hear everybody's story. So my name is Joseph Kamonto, and I live here just about a mile and a half from the office. So I hope it's good that the office is open again and we can come in. So I hope in the next few meetings, I will be able to come to the office. But I was born in Cameroon in West Africa, and I've been in the US for over about 35 years or more. So I came here to school, I'm married, and we have three children. Our oldest just came and visited with our granddaughter, and they moved from California to North Carolina, and I had a good road trip with him to go get them settled in North Carolina. So I was back about 3 weeks ago. And as the Lord would have it, my wife has some health issues. And so I'm at the point where I could retire. So I was thinking of working for about 2 more years, but decided to call it off by the end of this year. And so we are looking at moving to North Carolina for health reasons and for her to have some reprieve. So in fact, the Lord has worked a lot of miracles in our lives in the last few months, because in the just last month, our house just got sold, just sold our house. It closed last Friday. And in the 1 week that I was in North Carolina, we were able to get a house there and to buy a house. It's just incredible. So everything is going on in the Lord's, in the way that we could never have lined up things that way. I think it's a time for it. We are excited, and the Lord knows how to arrange things in our lives. So I came in, started in the ministry in 1992. We were in Los Angeles, and then we moved up here to Oregon because we were having kids, and it was hard to raise kids in Los Angeles without a family. And so we moved up here to be able to be close to my in-laws. So three children were born, two of our children were born down there. And the last one who was born here, Paul, is 29 now, and he just went back to school to get a master's in mental health counseling. So in fact, he interviewed Betty 2 weeks ago for his class. So that was quite a neat thing for him. And he's working at a counseling office here in Beaverton. They called him as a student intern, but when they realized that he had worked in the hospital with mental health issues, they just hired him. So that's a blessing, and he's doing that. And going to school, almost finishing this year. Our daughter lives in Bangkok, and she's been there for in Southeast Asia for about 4 or 5 years now. And the Lord is giving her a lot of challenges and to grow as a person, and she's using that to stretch and build up other young women of her generation. She's a she did a master's in here in PS Boston in national social work, and she got a journalism degree here in Portland. So she's using all of those skills to work with young women of her age, training them and getting resources for them, and just things like that, motivational speaking. So we have been with the ministry since 92, and I am, this is my third year of being in the board of the director. So I go off this year, Cindy. Remember that, yeah. So this is my last year of, but my third year of being on the board. And it's been a very, very rich experience for me to be involved in the ministry, because this ministry is unique. There is no other ministry or no training that you get, that you get in this ministry. That's what I was telling my son, Paul. I said, when he told me that they gave him the class and asked him to interview somebody about grief and loss, and he said, Betty came to his mind. I said, you will not have another person from whom to be mentored on a topic like that than Betty. So happy that he found time to interview her in the class. So I don't know what else to share, Cindy. About my spiritual life, I went to mission at school in Cameroon in Africa. From primary school to high school, and that's how I got introduced to the Bible and to Christianity. And at the age of 13, I got baptized just formally, because, sometimes the Lord is so patient with us. When we do things, when we are walking with Him, He guides us like children. So even at that time, I was very active in the church through my teen years and up my 20s, but it was just church activity, without knowing what the relationship with the Lord and walking with the Lord really meant. So around in my 20s, I really came to know that, and to really commit myself again to the Lord and walking with Him daily, or allowing the Holy Spirit to lead and guide me. It's one thing to be a Christian, it's a name, but walking the life like Jesus did, it takes the Holy Spirit. Again, that's one of the things that we've learned in this class, in this level one class. I've learned more about the working of the Holy Spirit and how to walk with Him and what His work is. He has a specific work in our lives, and we cannot deal with the Christian life without the help of the Holy Spirit. That's why it's called our helper. Mm-hmm. So this class has been a very good addition for me, because I've been trying all along to sit in the class, but with raising kids and working, it's been so difficult. But there's never again, it's never too easy to find enough time, as I found out. So you just have to jump into it. So I'm happy that I went through the level one class. I still have one class, one paper to give. So I'll work on that to finish that assignment on one of the assignments on the class on life stories, personal histories. So I hope even when we move, I will be with the Zoom possibility. I'm sure I will be able. I definitely will like to come back and do level two, because we never know what the Lord has for us and what He's training us for. When you're taking a class, sometimes you never know how it's going to come to use, but the Lord trains us, and He wants us to be ready for ministry wherever He places us. So like your prayers as we think about moving and all of the changes in life. And thank you for being part of our class. And I really enjoyed everybody and meeting with people from different places. So we have become family, and that's what we are. We are the family of the Lord. We are part of the remnant. So we really I really thank God for all of you, and hope that we stay connected one way or the other.
Okay, Joseph, when you finish your serving on the board, you're not finished. You know that, right?
Yeah. Once a Samaritan, you're always a Samaritan. That's the key.
There is no retirement in the kingdom of God.
No, there's no retirement. That's right.
We can retire from jobs, but we can't retire from working in the kingdom. So.
No. You just shift gears.
Yep, and it sounds like you got some big gears shifting.
Oh, yep. The Lord is leading the way, hopefully.
Thank you, Joseph.
Thank you.
Okay, how about Lorna and Arliss?
Yeah, she's getting up. I'm Lorna Schilling, and I've taken a lot of the classes, and I've taken classes elsewhere, and I've mostly been just like doing the classes and not the homework, which seems terrible, but it's been really busy. And just when I think, you know, oh, I'll have a little more time, because I retired last year, but I have less time as it turns out, because we're taking care of my aunt who's really not doing well. And our house is finally under contract. And we expect to close in a few weeks before August 6th anyway. And then we'll be building houses, and very excited about that. And so, yeah, I retired last year, almost exactly a year ago. And we moved down here to Coquille, which is absolutely beautiful and has been really helpful in healing us. And then since then, we've had all sorts of things happen, like Nick had a heart attack and a stent put in, and Mom's husband, Nick. And my aunt has had needed help and is getting more difficult by the day. And so, yeah, it's like always something. So a really cool thing that's happened is that I got a counselor through GSM, and it's Linda O. And I was super excited to have her as a counselor. She's wonderful. And I was like, she's my friend. Is it okay? Yeah. So we've had phone counseling, and we've just sort of we're going through my life history, but we started with grandparents and then parents. We haven't even gotten through that. I think we've had three times. And so it's interesting to be on the other side of the life history, and it's been really good. And it's surprising what things like get to you. I was talking about my grandma, and because my grandpa was really unfair, he gave my brother like everything, because my brother was the boy and the favorite child, and he gave him everything and wouldn't give me like basically anything without Mom getting on him. And my grandma would give us gifts that were like, you know, you'd get your gift and then you get $1.35 or something. That was the exact amount that the other person got. And that has been really, it's just really gotten to me, because, you know, she really cared to be fair. And one of the things we're going through with my aunt is that she's doing a trust, and she wants to give half her property to my cousin's daughter, and he has two sons. And so it'd be the daughter gets half of everything and then my cousin gets the other half. And it's like, she doesn't care about the fairness. And I just really appreciate my grandma more for that. And so the thing that we're planning on doing here is we'll be building a house that I'll live in and it'll have extra room. And I want it to be, well, I have been told that it's to be a retreat so that people can come and have peace and quiet and, or maybe not quiet, but peace. And so I'm really looking forward to what happens and, you know, the outcome of this. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. I'm Arliss.
Arliss, you look like you have like a halo.
Yeah. I tried to cover up the window a little bit, but it doesn't work very well.
Oh, that's all right. It looks good with that halo.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we're living in the house that I grew up in. I'm so glad to be back home. And I tell my family that I'm completely happy just being here. And it is absolutely beautiful out of every window because we're in the country and we have grass and trees and mountains and horses and cattle and wild turkeys and birds and deer and elk.
Yeah.
So we look out our windows and we see, you know, something new happening all the time, like a mother deer and her two little spotted fawns running behind her across our yard. So it's beautiful here. And so we do hope that there'll come a time when people can come visit us.
Yeah.
Okay, put me on the list.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So we're very happy that our house is in Portland is under contract and the inspection period is over. We have to regrout the chimney, but that's being taken care of. And we'll be closing before or by August 6th. So we're glad. I'm a retired librarian. I was a government documents librarian at the downtown Portland Multnomah County Library for about 29 years. And
yeah, I had you beat. I was there 32 years.
So, anyway.
Well, we're glad you're still joining us for class. We love having you here.
I am so thankful that we can do this by Zoom so we can still stay connected and see you guys and still learn things.
When I hear from you people, I think you guys are incredible. So it's really amazing to be able to talk together.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad to hear that your house is finally coming together and going to be sold. And
yeah, very exciting.
Give Nick a hug too, okay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He seems like he's doing okay, but he's really tired all the time now. I think it took I don't know if it took a toll or if it just, you know, is still a problem or what. He went to the cardiologist today, but, you know, he never tells us anything.
Well, you know, our bodies take a lot longer to heal than what we want to let them do.
Yeah.
My trauma training, they tell us if the doctor says to stay down for 6 weeks or to stay home 6 weeks, at least double that.
Yeah.
And they will tell you, the doctors will tell you, your body is recovering for at least a year.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
it's amazing what God can do to heal us, though. I am always incredibly amazed by what he's done and how he's worked things out, that like your story about Hannah's and mom, and it's like, you know, these things that you can possibly imagine being put together put together, and in a way that is it's like blows your mind.
Yeah, amazing. I think we have a couple more. We have, how about you, Sherry, and then we'll have Sabrina close. I think you will be the last ones, okay?
Well, hi. I'm Sherry Dunnigan, and I have been married for almost 43 years. My husband and I have 5 kids and 6 grandkids, and only 3 of our kids are married, so we got a couple more to go. But God's been very, very good to us, and I actually met Betty when a long time ago, like 1978 or 70, well, probably 79. And went to a family camp a long time ago with my friends and then, I mean, my parents and my husband. And then about 3 years ago, Betty came and talked at our women's ministries luncheon. And I really felt God speaking to me to, start going to class. So I did. And it's been really interesting. I work with, I homeschooled all of our kids. So I've had that. I've got to do really a lot of really cool things. I taught at a Christian high school for, I mean, it's just a couple of little classes, but it was really fun. And now I've been also facilitating a ladies Bible study. And so I really kind of wanted that foundation for counseling with that, because I know that I've had gals come in and have needed to talk, and it's been so helpful, the things I've learned here that will help me definitely with that. And I just love too that it's not up to me to make things better. It's up to the Holy Spirit. And He will guide me and lead me. And I like that, because it's not about me. It's about what God wants for these people. And so I'm really looking forward to that. I too am not good with paperwork. I'm a really good procrastinator. So I'm hoping to get mine all done by the end of August. So that, but I would like to keep still coming to class, because I really do enjoy the interaction. Zoom has been difficult for me because I'm a face-to-face person, but I'm learning to embrace this. And thank goodness we've been back to church for quite a while, so I've been able to have that face-to-face and physical connection, which I really appreciate. So, but you know, learn new things, grow. Listen to God, keep going. But I'm really thankful. And I have enjoyed too so much hearing other people's stories. A lot of people have gone through a lot of things. I've been blessed with the life that God has blessed me with. And I'm thankful, not that, you know, I haven't had my issues, but such pain and such sorrow, but such joy, because our God can heal. Mm-hmm. And He can strengthen, and He can make things better. And so that is awesome to know. So thank you all.
Okay.
Appreciate you.
And I don't know if Sherry said she's in Vancouver. And so went to level 1 in Vancouver and then joined us on Zoom for level 2. And then we have Sabrina.
Hello. Hi. I have furry animals in the background behind me taking class with us. And so I came to GSM through the man I'm married to now. We got married in 2018, but I met him in 2016 through something called Christian Mingle. But he was counseled by Betty. I think he went to children's camp when he was about 13. He's 54 now. And his dad and stepmom and his entire family have been seeing Betty as a counselor, and some of them have been very involved in the ministry at different times. Mark himself, my husband's name, Mark, was involved with the ministry for quite some time. And when we met, I really saw Jesus in him. And I said, man, I'm really digging this. And where'd this come from? And he kept talking about Betty and GSM and how he had been a rotten rascal when he was young, and how he was loved into being with other people who were rotten rascals and being loved by Jesus. And so I wanted to meet Betty, and I met her. And then I wanted to see Africa, and he took me to Africa, and I met Hannah, and I saw the work there. And GSM reminds me of my family of origin in a way that had really strong Samaritans as grandparents. And I missed them a lot. And I really saw Good Samaritan as an extension. It's something that I've been missing. I've been praying, where are these other people out there like my grandparents, in a way? It was like filling a void. Also in 2016, my mom had an aneurysm right in front of me, a brain aneurysm. She almost died. Was very traumatic. I had a couple businesses. I owned a couple businesses. I used to travel around the world. I was a single mom. I had this very busy life. But when that happened, it was the moment that the Lord really used to show me what was important. He reordered my steps. I sold off some things, and I cared for my mom for 6 months after her brain surgery. She had to learn to walk and to talk, and even swallowing, she couldn't swallow. It's similar like Louise, what she's gone through. Osborne, the head of the Uganda group, his wife, Louise, some of you may already know this, but so it really, the Lord slowed me down and really, I say he showed me himself. He forced change in my life, and it was beautiful. And so instead of doing like corporate work after my mom was healed, I started doing social work for the elderly and dying. And I heard their hearts. It was like time was standing still, and I was present with the Lord. And it was so beautiful. And I thought, man, I really like this. And I didn't go back to corporate. And I just, I kept doing that type of work. It didn't pay the same. That's okay. That's when I met Mark. And my mom is now fully healed. I have three sons. My youngest son just graduated high school this year. So this is definitely a time of empty nesting. All the boys are going away to college. The youngest one just decided, instead of staying in town, he's going away. So the Lord has really opened up just so many little steps for me to be with him. That's what I think of. Wow, I get to be with you, Lord, in these classes. I started taking the class because Hannah told me, will you take this Bible study with me? Maybe she said something differently, but I heard, oh, it's just a Bible study. And what I didn't realize is that this is exactly, I've been praying, Lord, do I go back to school for social work and get a degree in social work? Where am I going to go in these next few years? What's going to happen? And then little did I know what I stumbled into. So I did counselor training one. And I do want to say that I have an uncle now who, through the work that we've just been talking about through this counselor training, he wants to take counselor training. He went to theology school. He's 67, 68, and then ended up leaving theology school to become a nurse. But he is, our family is directly impacted already by the work of GSM through Mark and through this teaching and this training. And it's, I love it. I love hearing the stories. I love being humbled and being taught by the Lord. It's just really, it's Jesus time. It's time together. And I'm so grateful and I'm ready to go on to level two. I definitely think that it's great to have internationals with the Zoom, but like Hannah said, there were some difficulties with having somebody overseas and data. And I'd really like to be a part of just if there are other internationals who are joining in, maybe explaining how partnership could really help. If there's somebody here in the US that could partner with them, that's such a big, big help. Yeah, I really love this class. And I like to say, I know nothing. I'm just willing. Lord, take me wherever you want me to go. Thanks, everybody. Thanks.
We're glad you're here.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. That was fun. Mm-hmm. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. I learned new things about a number of people.
Are you going to tell us about you?
I think everybody knows about me. I felt like my story about Stephen was really my key thing tonight. But, you know, I'm here because I felt called to this position. Actually, I was in Kenya in 2007, and I had Nicholas Okungu basically prophesied over me that I would be in this position, didn't really name the title, but I just knew it in my heart. And then I went through 10 years of, okay, God, I guess not, before Teresa called and asked me to come into this position. But I just know I'm where I'm supposed to be right now, and that I'll be here until the Lord says something different. So. Looking forward to this year. And the Lord has opened up. I mean, I never would have put this on Zoom if we hadn't been forced into it by COVID. You know, and Teresa's the same way. You know, we're of that generation that it's, well, we see the value of the face-to-face, but there's also now that value in being able to reach so many more people. And we're going to continue to enhance our technology and get this better and better all the time, as much as we can. So yeah, and it is a challenge to teach between classroom and Zoom. I wish we could, I don't have enough time in my life to do all of it, or I would teach separately. I would do a Zoom class and I would do an in-person class. But we're where we are, and the Lord has it that way for a reason. Yeah. We're going to work with it. So yeah. What I'd like to do to finish tonight, we have about 45 minutes. I just want to do some light practice. First, I got to pull up a file here that I forgot to pull up before we started so that I can share it with you. So bear with me for just a minute with that. Actually, I should have put that on that. I shouldn't have. Okay, I'm hoping I'm okay. I got the right one. Um, So I'm gonna share a document with you and just teach for a minute. This will be very familiar to any of you who have done, all right, it's not showing up. Where to go? Who have done, that's not the one I want. Level 2-3 training, or if you went to the trauma healing seminar that I just did, this will be familiar to you. Well, shoot, it's not showing up.
Cindy?
Yeah?
Will you have another one of those trainings? Because I didn't know if it was going to be on... Zoom, said to put it on Zoom. Is that right?
Yeah, and it was recorded, so you can go and you can watch the recording. Shoot, I don't know why my
okay. So you did. That's the good thing. Share screen and then.
No, you have to choose the document first. The document's not there.
Right there.
It's here. But it's not showing up on my share screen.
Thing. You can see it on the
screen. Now we're seeing your whole screen.
On the screen behind you.
No.
Yeah, that's not what I want. No. I had this.
Right there is part of it.
Yeah.
Is that it, the orientation?
Yeah, but it's not working the way it's supposed to.
There you go.
Okay. Are you seeing that online?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Yay!
That just didn't, that's worked totally different than what I've ever done it before. So anyway, like I say, this is something that I shared during, I will be sharing again in this fall in the level 2-3 class, Sabrina. So you will get all of this. But I did kind of a crash course here with the evening and all day training to just introduce people to the concepts of trauma healing, because I really like a lot about the model, and I continue to teach what I always have about inner healing and, you know, the relational counseling, and especially bringing biblical principles and the scripture into everything that we do. And this is just a model, I call it the hamburger model by this picture. But it gives you a little bit of a template for a counseling session. And so the first part of any counseling session is what in trauma healing we refer to as orientation. And so orientation is simply connecting. So that when a person walks through your door, you as the counselor are going to, you're going to observe what state of mind, what state of physiology is this person in when they walk through the door? It's really not hard to see if somebody is really activated and, you know, maybe anxious or worried or upset about something. You can see it in their physiology. How many of you can say that you think you can do that? That if I came into the room and I'm like, oh, okay, we're ready to go now. That's pretty obvious. But sometimes a person can just be, you can just see their stiffness, or you can see them slumped over and their disconnectedness. There's many things that tell us you're not quite present here. You can tell that they're lost in their minds. They're lost in whatever is troubling them, whatever's going on maybe in that day or the whole previous week or whatever. And so the beginning of that type of a session would just be a time to connect. And so it might just be a little bit of chit chat about something pleasant, hopefully. I had a session like this just earlier today where the client came in very obviously distressed, upset, and typically because I know her very well. I knew that she would dissociate and not be present for the session, or just want to spiral off into the trauma, you know? And so I just sit down calmly with my cup of coffee and go, okay, let's spend a little time just looking around the room. And she didn't want to, and she started shaking her head no. And I said, and I just sat there and it's like, okay, we'll start when you're ready. Because she knows that I am not going to go any further in the session until she's willing to join me. Because if I tried joining her at that time, what she would do is just go off into that, the trauma vortex, the red part here in the sandwich. And what we need to stay here at the very beginning. We need to find this here, and we, until I know that that this person is present with me. And so I will usually have her identify a few things in the room, or maybe one thing, and just talk about that thing, to begin connecting with her own body. Okay, so what are your feet doing right now? You know, what are the sensations in your legs? Where are your hands? Where's your head? Where's your breath? I might go through some of those things. By this time, this client is very familiar with some of these grounding exercises. And she says, well, I've been doing the breathing exercise. breathe in, breathe out. And so I just get her talking about something that's totally different than whatever her trauma vortex is that she's been in, okay? And so you spend a little time. One of the ways to do that is to just simply say, okay, let's just take a deep breath together. So you're joining with them. And let your eyes go wherever they want to. And so a number of you have done this with me before, but let's do it again right now. I would like you to just join me in. Let's take a deep breath. And let your eyes go where they want to. And where do your eyes stop, or what are they interested in? What are your eyes drawn to? And a lot of times, you know, probably 90% of the time, our eyes are drawn to something that's pleasant. And just letting our eyes rest on something pleasant will begin to bring our physiology into balance. We'll begin to diffuse the cortisol, the adrenaline, those things that are amping us up. And it will begin kicking in that calming part of our nervous system just by thinking or looking at something pleasant. It was interesting though, when I did the trauma healing class, I did a demo, and I had a gal sitting here, and she's facing this picture, this big picture of Jesus over here on the wall. And so I did this with her, and I asked her where her eyes went, and she said to the picture of Jesus. And I asked her what was going on inside of her when she saw the picture, and it made her anxious. And so I did not expect that at all. So you can't determine ahead of time, okay, here's what this person's going to say about that, or this is what they're going to be feeling. And so when she explained to me the anxiety and the tension, it was like, well, that's interesting. Tell me more about that. You know, and so you work with them where they're at, but then I continued to work with her to find something pleasant that brought her, that calmed her down, that brought her out of the anxiety. And so you want to begin a session with the person in a calm state of mind. Colleen. So
what you just said, was that still part of like this orientation, or is that getting into healing?
It, you know, orientation and the healing vortex can kind of move back and forth with each other. Orientation just means that you're connected with me and you're connected with your environment and you're connected with yourself. But in doing that, you're probably going to be identifying something pleasant, something positive, something encouraging, something good that happened.
Which is the healing.
Which is the healing vortex.
Yeah.
Okay. And so those of you that haven't been through the trauma training might get lost in some of this language of healing vortex, trauma vortex. But the healing vortex is simply that place of peace, of calm, of rest, of safety. And so as a counselor, you're creating safety. You're letting that person know, I'm safe, you're safe in this place, you're welcome here. The healing vortex is connecting with something good, right, and positive. And this is where I love the word of God. God gives us this prescription. I just almost laugh in some of my training because it's all scientific and it's all so professionally based. And here's the physiology and this is how the nervous system is working. And I'm going, and this is why God says, praise me in all things, give thanks, and that he tells us to worship him, because this brings us into the healing vortex. That's what praise and thanksgiving does. And I had given this young woman an assignment of identifying things that she is thankful for each day. And she had brought that journal in and she wanted to jump off in what was her trauma for that day. And she was just anxious to dive off in this. And instead I just kept her in that, in the healing vortex. And you may spend the whole session in this. We spent probably 45 minutes just in that orientation and healing vortex, because she is so prone to dumping into the trauma vortex and going into the shutdown or the just blowing up rage type of thing. Her physiology would be often going into, and I'm going to do this in front of this camera, but often the clenched fist, the tightening and closing of the chest and the body and all of the muscles tightening, and even her toes turning in and her legs squeezing together. And so I will never begin a counseling session with her in that state of mind and physiology. And so I might just say, notice your hands. What are your hands doing? Well, they're in fists. Just soften your hands and open them on your lap. It's amazing the difference that will make in the way you're thinking and feeling. You might see their jaw clenched. Notice your jaw. And that you can't, when you notice it, you can't help but try to let it go. Notice your shoulders. And it's like, oh yeah, they're in my ears. But it's amazing just how noticing your physiology and the tension and deliberately dropping your shoulders, loosening your jaw, maybe rolling your head around a little bit, relaxing your hips, letting your feet rest instead of being tense. So these are all things that we can use in the orientation and healing vortex part of it. And what I did with her today was I could tell that she was still not totally present, and because she goes into a childlike demeanor, and she says, well, I have my journal with me. I did my assignment. I did what you told me to. It was like, teacher, look at me. I'm being good. I'm doing the right thing. And she started to bring it over to me, and I said, no, I said, sit down. I want you to share that with me. That's really powerful. And I want you to share each one of those things on your list very slowly And so she would share one thing and I go, okay, where do you feel that in your body? So I'm helping her contrast between this anxiety and tension that she came into the room with, to contrast it with, oh, when I say, oh, I'm grateful for the hydrangeas outside my window and the beautiful color. How does your body feel when you think of that? You know, because in contrast, in the beginning, it's like, oh, my gut's all knotted up, my fists are clenched, I'm tight. And she says, well, I don't feel anything. And I said, that's beautiful. How does that feel compared to what you were feeling? Oh, I guess yeah. Rich.
Okay. I'm not sure if you can hear me on this, but hello. You know, we want to look at like, oh, we can't wait to get to the trauma vortex, which is in the center of, that's when we really can get some work done. And no, what you're doing is right off the bat, you're teaching them how to self-soothe.
Yes.
So they can learn to do this when they're not in the office by role modeling it. Mm-hmm. And that's a tool that right off the bat, you're teaching just as an important tool. Then if you never get to that trauma vortex for a month, oh, well, that tool is, so we shouldn't poo-poo this. Like, oh, it's not, that's just warm up, you know, at least that's how I view certain things. Like it's the introduction and then we get the first act, but really the important thing is the trauma because it's colored red, you know, but the orientation is equal weight. Really?
It's actually, I think, more weight.
Yeah.
Because so many people are trapped in the trauma vortex. They're in this hyper-vigilant, hyper-tension, high state of anxiety all the time, or even a low-grade anxiety all the time. But there's always this underlying adrenaline, cortisol, hormones running through the system. And so practicing coming into being oriented with my surroundings, being connected to being able to come out and connect with something good, positive, encouraging, heartening, you know, is critical. We're teaching these people, we're teaching and ourselves, you know, we need to teach ourselves to be balanced. And that's why I encourage people to do the grounding exercises and orienting things when you're not activated. So, because the more you practice it, the more available it's going to be when you do become activated. And to not judge or condemn yourself when you do get activated and I try these skills and it's just not working, you know? It's okay. Just notice that and notice what you're feeling. Take a deep breath. Use all the tools that you have. And it may work a little bit. You may feel a little bit calmer than when you came in. I will stay with somebody in the orientation and healing vortex the whole session if we have to. And like I say, it was probably 45 minutes before she got to that place where she was the adult talking in an adult voice and being able to process and work with what had happened earlier that day. And when she got to that point of being calm, talking in an adult voice, she said, can I share with you what happened earlier? And I says, okay, let's do that. So she began to share. She started to go back in and I go, okay, just open your hands up, rest them on your lap, take a deep breath, but I just only have her touch it and come back out. So what I wanted to do tonight, for we have about 20 minutes left, is to just practice that and to break up with two people in a group, and we'll do 10 minutes
Each of you will just have 5 minutes to share, to do a little bit of orienting. And you can't do it wrong, okay? Because basically you're gonna break into groups and or two and two, and you're just gonna talk for a little bit. And you're gonna notice each other. And try to help that person find something positive. Something good, something right, something of value. Does that make sense? This is a very good practice for us.
One more.
Rich.
I read a book on trauma by this therapist that she had a patient where she spent the first 2 years in this before they could even get to the trauma.
Yep.
So it's
that's patience. Possible. That's possible. Because what's happening when you're doing this is the nervous system is rewiring. The nervous system has been in this activated hyper state for so long that it doesn't even know how to let down or what it feels like when it does. So you're helping them find that place. In trauma healing, we call it coherence. I'm coherent now. I'm balanced. Okay. So, questions about that before I put you in a room for 10 minutes. Okay, well, that's good.
I have one question.
Okay.
So to start, is it basically we just are, one person is going to be the counselor, the other one is going to be the client for 5 minutes.
Yes.
And then as if we're sitting down for our first counseling session or in a counseling session, is that right?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
And we have an odd number in here. I don't know whether that's counting our this room or not. So I'm just gonna put you in the breakout room. And if nothing else, just see this as a fun time to get to know somebody a little bit better, okay? That's what this is about.
You can either put my, I could put my mom on a different, on her phone instead if you wanted, or she can just be listening and she's
listening
laying down there.
Good for me.
She's laying on my bed, so. She just as soon relax.
Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and put you into the breakout rooms and we'll see how it turns out. And I might move somebody if I feel like I need to see him after I see what this is going to do.
You have
okay, I have three in that room. Okay, so I'm gonna move one person here down to room four. There we go. And I'm going to move this to actually let them move
the computer is saying nine.
Yeah, computer but it included
that's why she was
it included this her. One. So
I'm gonna look at this. Oh, like that.
That's two.
Right.
Four, six.
So again, some people who are not doing
but that computer counts. One of those two is one. We count as two.
Oh, I think.
Okay. Walter's not joining. So Alta, are you joined? There we go. Okay, I think we got it. So help me watch the time here. And I'll remind them to change here in about 5 minutes. So you guys pair up and do the same thing with each other.
Five,
you two?
Five. Okay.
Okay. And
sure.
Wait,
I mean,
which
one? Yeah, I don't know.
The client or the
all.
And you said
I'll show you what I did.
You're kind of a cheater. I'm a cheater. I'll let you do that.
I'm a cheater.
You're a cheater.
See, I printed out something for how to do this. Yeah, because my wife found this article today on the newspaper. And she sent it to me, and said, you might like this. And I thought, I'll show you. So I'm just gonna cheat. I'll just give it to you. Then I'll give you this cheat. And then you can do it for me. All right. So yes.
I thought I also
drink
some water.
Yeah. And can you see how it's working for you right on
that article? Yeah, I'm used to it.
So if I can do anything to help you, let me know.
Okay.
My mother was married. Yeah. Her second husband was.
We did six.
I had a traumatic brain injury. And so I'm really used to, I mean, you're really doing great. I know they're all different.
That's right. That's one of my main points.
Yeah, they're all different, but I'm familiar with that because that was my father. Okay, so unclench your jaw. Unclench it. It's clenched. And just breathe. Just take a deep breath. Unclench it.
Okay, so I'm going to suggest that rather than telling her to unclench her jaw, just say, bonus your jaw.
Oh, okay, that's good. I like this. I've got to get the teacher. This is why I came in.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I am.
Okay, so notice your. You really get touch with the Holy Spirit when you're going through and writing out.
I never had done that.
I think that's a level three. Yeah.
She said the
notice your neck and shoulders.
No, I only did the 5-minute one.
Oh, okay.
You know, they had a 5-minute one. No,
when I think about my shoulders going down.
No, jumping to me. I'm so
forcing them down. I guess she's going to tell us
forcing them
rather than doing this. We tend to get kind of focused one way, and it's good for you just kind of roll your eyes around it. You get permission. Roll your eyes side to side. Blink
a few times. kind of have a fresh refresh.
Yeah.
Like so refresh
it
works
out loud.
Your eyes.
Well, that was really good.
You was encouraging to hear that. When I said that, I said,
really?
Really hard
to try
to figure out what
I to get this patient because I'm in this room and I have to orient myself right, even so I'm doing a lot of work.
So you're more hyper-visual with your eyes.
Yeah, I want that.
What's good to be working?
Like even tonight.
Yeah.
A
it can be a little eye
exercise. I forgot to say.
You know,
it
does. I only did it on this today, but it does make a difference.
Yeah.
I notice when I tried it.
Yeah. And I think we end up saying it over and over again. Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
This one,
yeah.
It helps you to unclench your jaw. It
so, okay,
your
we're about ready to switch roles here. Okay.
And
it doesn't matter if you didn't get very far. Just practicing.
Last thing,
two and three get very minutes. Okay, two and three again.
Although this is probably a good way to try it.
And you can do whichever you want. I'm going to use that trick.
You don't
just
want
to think about, you know, what
you can do whichever you
want to share.
Honestly, I
want to
go over what you were talking about.
Oh, yeah, we're switching your momentum. Also, now,
I mean, that's the answer.
Yeah, you're the counselor. I'm walking in on hyperactive. Yeah, I'm just.
My question is,
I need a lot of help. I can't wait to start talking about all my stuff. It's not natural. I don't want to do that, but it's good to do
someone else. And do it again. So I think it's part of your life whenever I go. Okay, so if you were just talking to me out, that would not have done well, too. Is that okay? Show me where that is.
Belly. It's my belly. So, belly all the way down here to my ears, filling all the way down here.
And I can do a research paper.
I can teach. That's what I was trying to teach for an hour to an hour and a half. She said,
Yes. That's what's supposed to be.
I'm happy to ask more I need to know because I've been writing.
One thing I was about to do is
which do I do?
I bet I do that a lot. I bet that I am. I've got a tense belly breath.
So if you really have now that you notice that,
but what do I do?
So
it was just what I needed.
One thing I tried to make force my shoulders just make them go down. And then
when you say you write
where your side piece going to tap.
It's kind of like classic. You get that push down in a way it comes.
Well, one of the things is, do you think I'm going to do the feedback on the 14th?
Yeah. Going down reminds me to get the breath.
So it gives me a title, and then I go from there. So one of the things
move your head, and just like let your ear rest down close to your finger.
That's a stretch. I'm tired.
And
I know I wasn't actually.
Oh,
one is the upper shoulder.
It helps breathe so, that paper. It's a camera line.
I'm writing it down. You know, that is the same.
I think it's just the back of my neck. This is the same. You're not actually
really reading. Everything that God teaches me, right, because I've learned it, because you've experienced it. Right. And like some of my writing is because things happen in front of me, and I'm just
and
another thing, the title of this
is okay. We're gonna get ready to come back to the group here
because of something that happened to me. It was a vanity that came into my life, and you know, I mean. I'm thinking
that take a mountain because you're not hiding those by little doing and then both they,
you know,
they now get up.
So that's how those two papers come
about. Well, my hands went out too.
So I wrote down all these types of
movies
that I grew up in.
That's great.
And then you probably don't get that out this way.
Thank you.
Well, my friend added the woman's
rich. Oh, yeah, you're right. You saw that.
Oh, by the way, rich.
I got
my hat started for you.
Oh,
congratulations.
Thank you. Woo! Oh, my gosh, yeah. This is double day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do your paperwork.
Congratulations.
I took 2 hours.
That's on the
refrigerator.
My mom.
3 miles.
Good job, Holly.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, are we all back?
Oh, really?
Unfortunately, we have a little less than 10 minutes here, but so we're not going to have time for everybody to share. But if you got something on your heart or a question about what you just experienced, I want to hear from anybody that has a insight, a question, a comment before we close. So speak up, whoever wants to.
I really liked how in thinking about like your feet or your hands or whatever, you and the breathing, it just calms you down just by doing that. And it's kind of, I find that sort of incredible and really cool, because it's like, it might be a 180 from where you were. And yeah, all you do is this little thing and poof. It's like, oh, forget to breathe. Don't forget to breathe. And it's like, it's so incredibly important to take deep breaths every so often when you're stressing out.
Yeah. Yeah. Any, what other comments are?
Well, I have a comment about that very thing. That's something I learned in DBT, how fundamental breathing is in calming you down and activating that parasympathetic.
Yes.
So, and when we were practicing.
Oh, you're not in front of the camera, by the way.
And when, wait.
There you go.
Hi, sorry. And when we were practicing, I kind of got stuck on the breathing part because, I don't know, because I'm a singer and it's all about breathing. And so I kind of got into that, you know, but I know it helps. So I think it's a good place to start anyway. So lucky me that I focused on it.
Good. Other thoughts or comments? Anybody online?
The dogs were wrecking havoc and beauty at the same time in my background during my counseling session. They connected with Marion, and I was excited to be connected to her. I know we're not supposed to have favorites, but I already was interested about hearing some of the work that she's done over the years in the different places that she's been. And I look forward to hearing more of her story. But she had said something in the room to that brought me joy. And it was, I felt I was there present rather than just taking the class. She and I were together and I was listening to her and I was present. And that's what you were saying about orientation, that it's, we're together and we're here. Yes. And I really did feel that in the time with her. So thanks.
Can you see how this helps create safety? Mm-hmm. Of just connecting and talking about something positive in the beginning, being aware of your body and yeah.
You know what? I feel like I kind of lost track of that because I got so into the breathing part. But like that's one of the main things is is reorienting and connecting. And sorry, we got some good breathing in there.
Basics, good enough.
Okay. Yeah.
When we were talking, I looked at her body language and her body language was relaxed. So I didn't even go into the breathing or anything like that, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you stayed more in the healing vortex realm?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I felt the same way with Vicki.
Okay.
She seemed very relaxed and we just talked about level one, level two, and we just had a nice conversation.
Yeah, and sometimes that's what orientation is. You just have a nice conversation. Mm-hmm. And as a counselor, though, you want to be careful that you don't end up just spending an hour in a nice conversation. And that you do move on to what would you like to work on today, or we agreed that we were going to work on this area, you know. But it's, you need that transition time when, especially if somebody's coming out of heavy traffic and into your office, you know, and they're stressed just getting there. Maybe nothing big's gone on all week, but driving was it. I had a man over in Vancouver a couple weeks ago who came in like that, and it had been really heavy traffic, and so he was anxious because he felt like he was running late, and then there was road construction, and he got stopped about a half a block before the entrance into the county. And so by the time he got into my office, he was just wringing his hands and so stressed out and so apologetic. And I said, okay, let's just take a few breaths. And he says, oh, I'm just so stressed. He kept rubbing his arms and his hands. And I said, just notice your hands right now. He goes, oh, he says, I can't help it. They're in so much pain. And I says, yeah, just think about your fingers right now. What are your fingers feeling? He says, they're so painful. And I said, well, is there any place in your body that isn't? And he says, well, right in the palm of my hand. He says, my fingers really hurt, but my palms don't. And I go, okay, just, I'd like you to just think about the palm of your hand and just kind of shift in your mind from the pain in your fingers back to the palm of your hand. The pain in your fingers to the palm of your hand. And I mean, within 3 minutes, the pain was gone out of his hands and his nervous system was totally calmed down just by shifting, noticing something that wasn't painful. It's almost like the lack of that transferred to his hands and he was just shocked. But it's the anxiety itself created the pain in his hands. And being able to focus on a place there wasn't pain helped alleviate the anxiety as well as the pain. I mean, it is fascinating how it works, but it's like I just boggles my mind the wisdom of God in these things when he says, be anxious for nothing. But in all things, with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, Let your request be made known to God. That's the wisdom of our bodies, because he knows when we do that, our bodies will calm down. Our brains will be able to hear again, be able to process again. I'm going to close with just one other really simple thing that is also just feels like this mystery. But you know how when we're reading, when we're looking at a computer, or even we get ourselves so that we're so focused, and so we're always, our attention's always this focus right here. I'm focused on you, I'm focused on you, I'm focused on this task, my keyboard, my, you know, whatever, my phone. For just a minute, soften your eyes and let yourself be aware of your peripheral vision, up, down, around the sides, and still just looking straight forward. But just soften your eyes and let your eyes be aware of everything. And just sit for that for a minute here, just letting your eyes rest in the peripheral vision, and notice what happens in your body as you do this. What do you notice?
My breathing changed.
Okay, your breathing changed. Anybody else? What did you notice?
I just felt relaxed.
Mm-hmm. Do you know that that simple thing helps engage your parasympathetic nervous system? It takes us out of that focused, what they call foveal vision. And it softens everything. And the more that we can practice, it's like, if you're looking at your computer or your phone or reading or doing anything where you're doing this focused attention, you know, every once in a while, put it down and just do that. And you'll be amazed at how it brings calm to you. And we all need to be practicing that as much as we can, just noticing the peripheral. I mean, you can do a lot of tasks, even driving, and being aware of the big picture instead of just this narrow little tunnel in front of me. Because this causes tension. And noticing the peripheral brings relaxation to our nervous system. Pretty simple, but it's amazing the difference it makes. I've been working on that, and I am... And it works. it helps, you know. So think about that. Who would like to close us in prayer tonight?
I'll pray.
Thank you, Johanna.
Yes, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this class. We give you all the glory for everything that you have done for us, Lord. Thank you for all the testimonies, the stories, everything you have heard from the classmates and from our teacher, Lord. Lord, we thank you that you help us to put everything that we have learned in practice. Help us to always remember to breathe, to relax, and not to be anxious for anything. King of Glory, continue to lift altar. She say that we lift them up, Lord, as the mothers are dying of COVID, Lord Jesus. We pray that, Lord, you send your word to heal in the name of Jesus. Rescue the mothers, rescue the children, rescue everyone in the mighty name of Jesus. We continue to pray for Zambia, for his healing in the mighty name of Jesus, Father, comfort them on every side in the mighty name of Jesus. We pray for your healing hand to continue to touch each and every one, the families and everyone, the Samaritan around the world. King of glory, thank you that you're touching us all and you called us in such a time as this to use us, my God, in your kingdom business. Father, Lord Jesus, we pray for our classmates who have not been available today, that Lord, you teach them also in the name of Jesus. Thank you for our other classes. Thank you for those, all the assignments you have given us. We pray that you give us the grace to do everything that you've told us to do. We give you all the glory, for the eyes have not seen, neither our ears heard, what you have prepared and purposed for us. We give you praise because we are healing and we are touched, we are empowered. We are, Lord Jesus, what you say we are in you. Father, we thank you for our teacher, Mama Cindy. Continue to bless her. We soak everyone in the precious blood of Jesus. Father, go ahead of us, even others as they are going to sleep and others are going to work, whatever everyone is going to do, we place it into your hands. We give you praise and thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Hannah.
Amen.
You're welcome.
Amen.
Good night to you all.
Bye-bye. Bye, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Hi. Good night. Thank you so much. Nice to see you guys again.
Yeah, nice to see you guys.
Bye bye.
Yes. Nice to good see night. You. Thank you very good much.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Night. Good
God
morning.
Bless.
God bless you, Alta. Nice to
thank
see you.
Thank you. Bless you, Sabrina. Bless you all. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Thanks, Rich. I'll be in DBT soon.
Oh, okay. Oh, I'm going to be also in DBT soon.
Yeah.
Great. Mm-hmm. Awesome.
Bye.
DBT, thank you. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Cindy.
Thank you.
Rich, how to? Bye, Rich. I want to also be attend to DBT class.
Oh, okay. That'd be great. Love to have another middle school teacher.
Thank you.